Podcasting today from our studios in Vancouver, BC, Canada. Welcome to the show that confirms safety does indeed have a personality. This is a podcast unlike any other where we talk about safety differently and get to know our guests on a completely different level. This is the show where we not only get insight and professional opinion from our special guest on current and ongoing safety themes, but we get to know them on a personal level. We even get to hear what's on their music playlist. Today, we find out what kind of music moves our guest and what safety events our guest is moved by or a part of professionally. This is Safety Debris with me, Richard DeLong, and my Safety Debris partner, Tanya Steele.
Hello, Richard. It is so great to be here with you again today and with our listeners. And I am very excited about our very special guest for this podcast. Tell us about him.
Well, our special guest today, Tanya, has been described by his safety colleagues as one of the most awesome, humble, and multi-talented people in the world. He's known as a safety leader in our industry, having provided guidance, mentorship, and education through a variety of professional and volunteer roles in both Central and Eastern Canada. He also has been described by colleagues as a person who continues to be a positive influence and a reminder that our profession is responsible for demonstrating compassion and caring through all of our actions. In addition, he's a talented musician, playing and recording with his own bands over the years, and collaborating one-on-one with other musicians on a variety of musical projects and interests. He's originally from Bridgewater, Nova Scotia, and resides in Bridgewater. He's married to Janice. They have 4 adult kids, 6 grandkids. He's a consultant. He has his own business. It's called Workplace Performance Management. Ladies and gentlemen, please join Tanya and me in welcoming Stewart Franck to Safety Debris.
It's so great to have you here, Stewart.
Thank you so much. This is quite an honor. I'm thrilled. And I very much look forward to speaking with you for the next moments.
Awesome. That's awesome. Well, we asked you before the podcast to tell us about your favorite song. And you stated to us, I have so many friends that tease me, is every song your favorite song? You said, being a patriotic Canadian, O Canada tops your list, tied with Hockey Night in Canada theme. Who are we to say anything different, Stewart?
Well, hockey in Canada and O Canada. I remember singing O Canada at the top of my lungs in an American bar restaurant when Sidney Crosby scored the winning goal at the Olympics.
Yes.
And I just forced everybody to get up and sing. Oh, even Americans were singing along with me.
Let's gather all our Canadian fans and our American friends and just hum along to this little beauty. You know, it's incredible how many versions were to choose from on that one. That one seems a wee bit slow, but it was still good. Brings back Saturday night around the TV.
I hate to say this to you folks out in Western Canada, but go Leafs, go.
Yeah.
we still love you, Stewart. And as a fellow Canadian and a daughter of a Canucks fan, I agree about those two choices of music for sure. And so tell us, since we're talking about music, we're starting off here with music. Tell us about the other favorite song you shared with us that strikes a personal chord with you that we wouldn't necessarily have guessed on our own.
To me, I spent a little bit of time in Jamaica. And I got turned on to reggae music and Bob Marley and Peter Tosh and all those folks. It's just fabulous spiritual music. It's so uplifting. One Love strikes a real chord with me because it talks about, you know, people coming together and working on problems and, you know, solving all the world's issues. And we can do this. We can accomplish that. And that song is so hopeful to me. And like a lot of other reggae songs, a lot of hope.
Yeah, That is a great song. And you know, I didn't realize this, Stewart, and maybe you knew this because you lived down there, but that was his first single, and he released it back in 1965. Did you know that?
I didn't know what year that was, but it was quite early. It was I lived in Kingston, Jamaica around 1970-ish for a while, and it was a big hit. All those Bob Marley hits were huge back then.
Yeah, so that still would have been fairly young on the charts back 65, 70. Yeah, so it would still have been just a few years old. But what I've been to Jamaica once and did the tour of his home and saw his crypt with he's buried in this or he's yeah he's buried in the crypt at his home, and his mom is next to him in her own crypt, which is very cool. I did learn there that his mom was of course a native Jamaican, but his dad also native Jamaican, but he was white, and I didn't realize that until then, that he was actually a mulatto. And so yeah, very interesting story about Bob Marley there.
I totally never knew that.
And the other thing I learned about Bob Marley then was I thought he died of brain cancer, and it wasn't. It was melanoma. He died of skin cancer, and that's what he suffered from. And yeah, he died in, I think, his 1981. So anyway, we've got his music, and we love it. And yeah, it's got a great groove, and what a fun genre of music to listen to. It's one of my favorites as well.
Reggae band, a seven-piece reggae band down here, and I had to apologize because it's certainly the whitest reggae band you would ever find. But we had a wonderful time playing you know, roots reggae music, all of Bob Marley hits from early on, and it was so much fun. And it was, you know, the our audiences just loved it.
I was going to ask you about your band, and I'm glad you brought that up. So, and is the band still together, or do you guys disbanded?
We disbanded, unfortunately. Bands do that.
Bands do that, but you still play because you were, when we met you today, you were out jamming today.
Yeah, I still play in a few different groups here and there, and some collaborations. And, you know, in fairness, the reggae band lasted for probably a good 10 years, which is a good longevity for most bands. And I was out today hosting a jam session. We actually had a little bit of reggae being played there, which was fun. And so we had different artists, different styles, different calibers of musicians coming on stage. Such a nice spiritual positive feeling that even so, some musicians weren't really all that good. I shouldn't say that. They were all great. But they were all accepted by everyone. And just, you know, we couldn't hug because of COVID, but it was still fun to have them there.
Yeah, that's awesome. It's so great. You know, even right now during this time, music really has been a healer for a lot of people. And we hope that if you are listening and you are driving in your car right now or wherever you are, that the music that we're playing for you uplifts you as a safety professional, because it's tough. It's a tough time right now. And music really has a way of bringing everybody together and feel like you're connected.
So, Stewart, you worked in the mining and chemical industries, and you were a graduate of computer sciences. Why did you end up choosing safety as a career?
That's an interesting question that came about quite by, I shouldn't say by accident, that would be a terrible pun. But having, you know, looking for work after I went back to school, finished off school when I was 30. I already was married and had a couple children. So when I graduated, I started looking around. It was hard to find jobs that suited, you know, what I needed to raise the family. And so I saw a job advertised in safety, and I thought, well, maybe I could do this. You know, having worked in mining where, you know, safety is drilled into you, I can still recite some of the things that we learned before we went underground every day. And also working in the chemical industry, a lot of auditing processes going on there. I learned a lot about that. And so I thought, well, maybe I could use this. So I rejigged my resume a little bit. I didn't lie about anything, but I kind of focused on some of the safety-related things, and I got the job, not knowing how difficult it was to be a safety professional, to manage safety in a large organization. You know, we had about 4,000, 5,000 employees and about 90 locations, and I was very, very green. And 2 weeks into the job, I went to my boss and I said, you know, I'm not the person for this job. If you knew what you wanted, you would never have hired me. You must have someone else that you can call that's more qualified. And they were so wonderful to me. They said, you know, we hired you because we want you. And they said, what, you know, they threw at me whatever it would take, whatever it takes to help you do the job successfully. Wow. We will support you. So that was just amazing. That was, you know, that was at the Niagara South Board of Education. I was living in Ontario at the time. Last year, it was a bit of a, it was a joke. You know, it really was a joke. They thought they took safety seriously, and they, you know, they would preach safety, but at the same time, it was all about profit, and it really safety was secondary. So, you know, make sure that you find the person that has the interest, and, you know, he or she may not have all the skills necessary, all the education necessary right away. Now we have more people that are graduating with safety backgrounds, safety, you know, diplomas and certificates and degrees, which is great. But back then we had none of that. And so find that suitable person and make sure they're the right fit for the organization, because just because they're highly educated doesn't necessarily mean they're going to do the job well. You got to relate to people. And if you can't listen to people and relate to people and really make people right here in your heart and your mind, make them part of everything that you do, every decision you make, then you're not going to be successful. And the company, the employer is not going to be successful unless they have the right person in that job.
You know, I had the opportunity to work on the hiring guide way back when the first original one with Bruce Jackson, extraordinary man. I can't take any credit for it. I just showed up at the meetings and Bruce really guided us through all the education because he was just so knowledgeable in all the safety professional designations and the different types of training all over the world. And he created this hiring guide, as you said, which is truly spectacular. And I hand it out quite regularly as well. And so let me ask you this question. How important is it for safety professionals and those aspiring to be in this profession, pursue education, training, and designations?
I think it's quite important to be at least accepted in the field. People are looking for professional designations because they may not know what else to look for. And so if you have that degree, diploma, certificate, that the professional designation, the CHSC or CRSP or CIH or ROH, those are really important designations to have. And they're a testament to what you've learned and what you've put into your own career and developed it. They're not everything, but it's a real good start. And so if you need to weed out, select from the masses, try to find, you know, who are the best people, you want to look at those designations. However, it's not everything. I mean, there are textbooks on safety that we can read, but you're not going to learn until you do it. It doesn't matter how many degrees or certificates you have under your belt, until you do the job for a while, you get lots of experience. I keep saying that, you know, you need a degree in medicine, law, industrial psychology.
I'm out.
you need all of these things in one package, and it's so much to know and so much to learn, and you have to be patient and know that, yeah, it's like this huge, like that woman that, you know, recently did a huge, like 10,000 piece jigsaw puzzle. You know, you start with one piece and you start putting it all together and you get the edges and you start to fill little things in. That's how we are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As safety professionals, you know, I'm not totally filled in yet. I've still got some holes that I got to find to patch up, you know, and every time I meet someone, I learn more. And every job I do, I learn a little bit more.
Yeah. I like that analogy, Stewart. That's a good way to put it. I'm not full yet. You know, I'm still putting on some pieces here. Yeah, and you know, I have to agree with you. This is a people business, right? It's how you relate to other people. So I can't disagree with that. And of course, I have had the pleasure of meeting you on at least two other occasions, and you may recall, both at the CSSE conferences. The first was in 2018 at Niagara Falls, and then the following year in 2019 in Winnipeg, where I had the opportunity and pleasure to be the MC for both conferences, and that was a lot of fun. And
great
of course,
job, by the
stories. What's that?
It was a great job. You did a wonderful job, and it made the conferences so much more enjoyable for everyone that attended.
Well, thank you, Stewart. Those are kind words. I appreciate that very much. That's very kind. And you know, it's funny because being the MC, people are always coming up to you, asking you questions. They have suggestions. They have ideas. They're telling you what happened in their circles and what's gone on with them at the show. And of course, the stories came to light the next day. You know, I learned that you are an instigator of fun and good times with guitar in tow, which is a good a good reputation to have. But there was a buzz about this impromptu concert. And I'm thinking more along the lines, the one in Niagara Falls, because if, correct me if I'm wrong, but I understand that you helped to organize a little impromptu get together with other fellow CSSE musicians. And you got into this this club or this restaurant that was dead quiet. And by the time the night was done, when you shut her down, she was packed to the rafters and everybody had a great old time. Is that any close proximity to the truth of that night?
I don't know what you're talking about.
he's lying. I remember that night.
The bar actually, I actually had visited the bar early in the day. And I said, you should have a couple extra staff on board and you might want to check your supplies of food and your bar. And well, we emptied the bar. They ran out of alcohol.
There you go.
Something about those safety people. We consumed an awful lot that day and we had a lot of fun. It was, you know, some people from all over Canada, Nunavut, Newfoundland and Nova Scotia and Ontario. I think maybe Bob was there from out in Vancouver, out in Edmonton, sorry. Yeah. And I think, you know, it was just great to see everybody come together. The conferences are fun, enjoyable, entertaining. And yes, also, you know, we get professionally developed while we are there. But you add a little bit of fun and enjoyment. You remember those events and you just can't wait. We just can't wait until COVID's finished so we can do that stuff again.
Yeah, we're looking forward to that. That will be a lot of fun. So we can't help but notice there, Stewart, in behind you, it looks like a jam room. So we know you're a musician and looks like you got a drum kit set up. There's a select few guitars hanging up on the wall. Apparently you play a few things.
I spend my time down here quite a bit and outside the off screen, there's a bar over there too, which helps a lot. But I spend some time down here with my friends or even just on my own, just, you know, strumming a few songs and that kind of thing. And we doing some recording and some writing. This is kind of a favorite, old favorite song of mine by Van Morrison. Yeah. We were born before the wind. A lot of sailors here in Nova Scotia. Also younger than the sun. Here the bonny boat was won as we sail into the mystic. Hark now, hear the sailors cry. Feel the wind and touch the sky. Let your soul and senses fly into the mystic. And when that cold, cold blows, I will be coming home. Oh, yeah. And when that foghorn blows, I wanna feel it. No, I don't wanna fear it lie. Just wanna rock your gypsy soul, just like way back in the days of old. And majestically we will flow into the mystic.
Really nice.
Great song, isn't it?
That was awesome. Right here. Live. This is so great. Thank you,
Stewart Franck. Yeah. That is a real treat. Thank you, Stewart. That was really nice. I enjoy that. I'm sure you feel the same, Tanya. I love people pick up guitars just impromptu, and it's just so much fun. You know, people just collect and just want to sit and listen and hum and sing along. It's fun. It's great stuff. Thank you.
Well, you mentioned earlier about music being a stress relief, and we need that. And music certainly does that for me. It always has.
Yeah. And it's, you know, I love it because not only do I love music, but I can't play anything. So I always find it really extraordinary. I'm like, this is amazing. And then when somebody can pick up two or three musical instruments, it really is a special gift that you've worked hard at, and I can't do any of it. So I always sit in awe of people who could do that. So thanks.
I'll give you a warning now, and maybe a bass solo next. So watch.
So Tanya didn't inherit the musicianship genes from your dad, because I understand he played the skins. He was a drummer.
He was a drummer, and I grew up with drums. And I was telling Stewart, I said, we had a room that looked just like the room that he's sitting in. And my dad would play drums on the weekend. He would practice. And as a kid, I would sit in the hallway and go, I'd want to be a drummer. But back then, women just didn't really do those kinds of things. And I think I picked it up a couple times, and he just went, oh, I love you, honey. And it was something I just wasn't good at. So
want to hurt your feelings.
No, he played in a band. He
stunt
sang.
Your growth.
I don't got any of it. None of it.
Well, that's okay. You're lovely in many other ways, and we appreciate them.
Yes, so you are.
I know your dad does too.
Your safety is a career, dear.
Yes. You be a leader in safety. Leave the drumming to me. You know what? And we talked about COVID here being a bit of a challenge. But there's lots of challenges, Stewart, for employers. I think every employer has experienced the challenge of hiring and retaining qualified people. It seems there's a bit of a labor shortage right across the board. I think it's really a competitive area. And so what are some of the challenges you have seen companies experience when it comes to attracting young workers into the health and safety field?
Some of the challenges are not necessarily even opening their eyes to young people that are out there that right in front of them that could fill opening and maybe giving people more of a chance. You know, I still come across employers that are always looking for that person with the right amount of experience, a number of years of experience. And, you know, that's a real small pool of people is getting smaller. You know, I'm not coming out of retirement to do, you know, some hard work anymore. A lot of people are just, you know, not working. And those real good, talented, experienced people, they have jobs, and they're probably not going to leave those jobs. And so unless it becomes just a race as to who's going to afford these few professionals. So you're much better off, I think, I try to convey this to employers, you're much better off to find people that want to work for you and help them become that model employee that you want. Help them help them to grow out of your employment into someone else. And nothing better than helping people move on to that next job. Because if you really want to invest in your people, they're probably going to stay. And you train them, you make them the best that they can be, and recognize them. And I'm not necessarily saying money, but at least, give them that credit and recognition that they deserve. And they're probably going to stay for you. Now, when you're hiring young people, you know, make sure they get the training they deserve. There are so many young folks that go without training, not only safety training, but, you know, first day on the job. Where's the bathroom? Like some people don't even say those things, you know, like they might talk about where this is when you show up, this is when you leave, this is the quality of work, this is the quantity of work, but they never tell people, like, you know, we really hope that you will work with us to prevent injuries to yourself and others. You know, my very first paycheck I had when I worked in the mines, and I left after school and went up to northern Manitoba, not knowing what I was getting into, working in the underground, the mines. And I had my very first paycheck, and the mine captain ripped my check in half.
Wow.
And my first paycheck. And I owed everybody in town money. And this was before direct debit and, you know, automated banking. You actually had a paper check. that right. you had to pick up, stand in line to pick up on payday. And so my boss took that check and ripped it in half and said, this is for coming to work every day, doing the amount of work, the quality of work that we want you to do. And this other half is for doing it safely, for not getting hurt, not injuring other people, following those policies and procedures and whatnot. And that, you know, this person didn't know it, but he made a safety nerd out of me right there at, you know, 18.
Wow.
And I thought, wow, you know, they're asking me to do all these things, follow these safety procedures, and they're paying me for it too. Yeah. You know, yeah. Like, that's part of my job. Like, how beautiful is that? You know, so I tried to share that with the people I worked with, even back then. You know, they looked at me kind of strange. Yeah, I guess, yeah, maybe, you know, but to me, it really made sense. You know, mm-hmm. If I'm being paid to do this job, I'm going to do it the best of my ability.
So great. And, you know, we talked to Dylan Short as well on the podcast. And of course, you've made a huge difference in his life, mentoring him. So the stuff that's been passed on to you, of course, you're passing on to hundreds, if not thousands of safety professionals across our country and North America, and even globally, because we know that you're involved in some of that as well. If we had somebody who was new listening online right now, and they're driving and they're in a place of, man, I'd really like to get into the safety stuff, and I don't know, how can I stand out to an employer? What would you tell them that they should do or think of or take?
Well, try to get the education, try to get the qualifications. That's really important. And, you know, learn, and the formal and the informal education is really important. Surround yourself with positive people. It's so contagious, and you can, find out what works, you know, find those success stories and follow those lines, because there's probably other kinds of stories that go along with them. And people that are successful really like to share, really like to talk about their successes and share that. They don't sell it necessarily. They want to give it away. And there are so many people that you can learn from. If you're a new person, let's say you're if you're working in safety. If not, I would really highly recommend people get into the safety career, because it's been really good to me and you perhaps, and yeah, you know, my peers. I think it's just a wonderful field to get into. And every day, every contact, I learn so much more from everyone else. So
what's your secret to success then, Stewart? What would you say was one of the things that you focused on to say, this is what I did, or a couple of qualities that you did?
I've been very lucky. You know, there's a certain amount of luck involved as well. You know, you get really great people around you. They're going to help you. And, you know, there's some wonderful mentors I had that had lots of experience, and you're going to make mistakes, and you have to learn from those mistakes and be able to, you know, take it on the chin a little bit, maybe once in a while, fall down, pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and keep moving. But I think the key thing for me is to, you're going to find there are all kinds of people in the workplace. All of them deserve to go home safely, and all of them deserve to, you know, also to contribute. And the more that you can get them to contribute, to help themselves and help you do your job in health and safety, and to make the workplace more profitable, more efficient, then you are, you know, you all benefit from that, and you all grow from that. And so it's been a little bit of a team building thing. You had to be part of a team. I think some of the things not to do is, you know, to try to be the enforcer or the officer, where you're trying to catch people doing things wrong. You want to catch people doing stuff right, and you want to build upon that and you know, and celebrate every single success you have along the way. Yeah. There are textbooks, there are systems out there, you know, maybe believe some of that, but, you know, create your own systems and, you know, find out what works best for you. There are all kinds of models out there that people will say, you have to do safety this way. Well, find another way, find your own way, and you will get there. You take part of that, what you want, what turns you on about that, and learn from it and put it as piece of that puzzle again, and to fill up those holes that you need to package yourself to be that safety professional or whatever professional person that you want to be.
It's nice. I love three things that you said. Number one, find your own way. I think that's so important. Number two, celebrate every success, no matter how big or small. And, you know, we talk about, because you're we talk about mentorship a lot, and a lot of people have come on and said, you know, I've been a mentor, or I got mentorship. And, you know, to tell our listeners, like, that's something that we do on purpose. Like, we say, hey, grab mentors, but sometimes we don't say how. And I remember when I was in my 20s, I don't know if Richard, if you've done this as well, I assume that you have, but when I was in my 20s, I on purpose put people in my life. Like, I put somebody who was older, like I was in my 20s, I made sure I had somebody in my 50s that I had to go to who was an entrepreneur. I had somebody who was younger than me because I wanted to stay fun and creative. I had somebody who I wanted to be like. I had somebody who gave me emotional support, somebody who gave me entrepreneur support. And so I had five specific people that I wrote down their names and said, these are the people that I want to have around me and that I want to associate with for specific questions. And those people have, and they change throughout the years as you grow and you meet new people. But it's really something that you do on purpose. Richard, did you, I think you've done that, but did you do that?
No, you know, I've been a wreck most of my life. I didn't have that kind of foresight.
Yeah, we know that. I'm sorry to put you on the spot like that.
I call it,
but thank you for asking.
Go ahead, Stewart.
There's a little bit of thievery involved. And, you know, stealing this stuff too, you're going to find good things. Like, you know, I worked in the fishing industry. I had 1,300 member companies, and we started this organization called the Fisheries Safety Association of Nova Scotia. And we got, you know, 15,000 people engaged in fishing, and find one leader and you grab onto him. In this case, it was a male, and he ran a fishing company, and he had some really great thoughts about, you know, how to motivate people for safety. I said, do you have a health and safety committee? He says, yeah. I says, well, you know, what do you do? How do you train them? He's, oh, I get them all involved. And I got all the captains, everybody's on our health and safety committee. He's like, I'll have them all write a letter. Tell me what I need to say to your family when you don't come home from fishing.
Ooh.
So like, I've done it before. I can't find the words. So you help me. How do I tell your family that you're not coming home because you're lost at sea? Because yeah, you wouldn't wear a personal flotation device. So, you know, that's pretty powerful stuff. And that spreads far better than anything I could say or anything I could do. So I become a cheerleader more than a safety leader or motivator. I'm just there saying, keep that up. That's wonderful. You know, I love this stuff. And the industry slowly, it was a real challenge to take on that industry because without any exaggeration, I had at least, let's say, 3 or 4 death threats a month.
Holy, ah.
And because trying to instill safety, you know, preventative mindset in the fishing industry. And it slowly went away as they started to realize that, hey, yeah, we're saving money. We're paying less. We're having fewer injuries. We're saving a lot of money on workers' compensation payments and that kind of thing. And so that stopped. And they, you know, and I didn't have to do very much anymore except watch them, congratulate them, and support them, and, you know, whatever they wanted to do to make their industry safer. And it's still got a long way to go. Yeah. But they've cut their rates and injuries and costs in half over that, you know, span of years.
You mentioned cheerleading and being motivated. Tanya usually has a question that kind of relates to music in this vein there. Tanya, do you want to ask him what?
Yes, I do. Why, thank you for that tie-in, Richard. yeah, so, you know, and listening to your story as well as, you know, we do lose people. People do get hurt and we sometimes have some rough days or we're trying to teach people or we're trying to get them to understand or something bad has happened. And sometimes safety professionals just don't have a great day and we're feeling a little bit down and out. We're feeling a little bit frustrated. So let me ask you this question, getting back to music. If you're having a bad day, what is your go-to song to cheer you up?
Oh, my goodness. There's probably, music in general tends to cheer me up. And I could probably list off a bunch of songs. But this one doesn't sound like it's a real happy song. It's called When the World Ends by Dave Matthews Band. And the reason why it cheers me up is that, you know, I'm a big fan of silly love songs. Anything to do with a love song. Well, you know, One Love was in there earlier. But, you know, this is, to me, it's the greatest love song in the world. The world is falling apart. Mountains are crumbling into the sea. But it, you know, Dave Matthews sings about being with the one he loves. And, you know, and loving that person, regardless of what's going on around it. So I think it's, to me, that just is always happy.
Well, it just so happens we've got that song for you here, Stewart. And in fact, we've got a couple of songs that follow it. So we're going to play a little montage of the three songs that you said you find inspiration from. And this is the first one, the Dave Matthews Band, and When the World Ends.
When the world ends, collect your things, you're coming with me. When the world ends, when I'm alone, I sometimes get to thinking how it's gonna be when we're gone. Dream that I saw her standing there. They're running for the bullets and the man. I was hit hard by the lights of Brandenburg.
Nice little medley there. So these are three songs that Stewart finds inspiration from, his little pick-me-ups every once in a while. So that was Tom Cochran, Canada's very own. And we heard from Dave Mason and, of course, Dave Matthews. Great talents right there and nice selections. And thank you for sharing those with us, Stewart. Those were awesome.
You're welcome. That last one might have actually been a choice of my wife, Janice, so the boy inside the man. I think that's what she thinks I am sometimes. But you'll sometimes also notice there's something in common between those three songs. They all have very strong bass lines, and being primarily a bassist, you know, anytime I hear a great bass line, it lifts me up.
Good stuff. All right. Well, I got a question about influencers in your life, and those who inspired you professionally. Who would you list off, the top three?
Oh, my. There are just so many. There are, you know, one of my early supervisors when I worked in the mines underground taught me a line, which was, it's a very, you know, common line, but he used to always say, good enough is not good enough. You know, we got to get the job done, especially when you're working, you know, 3,600 feet underground, a lot of things go wrong. And, you know, nothing was ever good enough. It had to be excellent. It had to be perfect. And I think I worked in the chemical industry. I worked for what used to be called Union Carbide at the time. And I guess the gas products part of that. And one of the nicest people I've ever known. He was a really miserable curmudgeon when I first met him, but he turned out to be one of the nicest people I've ever met in my entire life.
My experience with Richard.
His name was Bill Roberts. So he was just a fine, fine gentleman. And you know, and also the people I worked with at the school district early on, they were just wonderful. And I worked in automotive, and I met some people down in South America that were just fantastic. You know, like I was trying to instill safety systems from North America in Brazil, and I found out they taught me how the safety systems in Brazil are far superior than what we're doing in North America. Wow. And so I had to come back and sell the Brazilian systems to the rest of North America and say, we had to follow these people. And so, you know, I still get the odd email from those folks down there saying, you know, thank you. They're thanking me, but it was all their work. And, you know, they were such motivators.
So Stewart, you notice the difference in the culture, I guess we'll say that, from Brazil to where you were working and practicing on the East Coast. So would you say there's a vast difference between what happens on the East Coast to Central Canada, to Ontario, to the West Coast? Would you say that it's similar, or are we all on the same page, or are we kind of not?
Our body temperatures are somewhat the same across and people are people, and I don't think there's a whole lot of difference. We we sometimes look at these artificial political barriers and lines drawn on a map to separate people from one province to another, or one country to another, but we're really all the same.
Yeah.
And one of the conversations I had in Brazil with a fellow on a Saturday afternoon at a pateca court, lobbing the ball back and forth across the net, I said, you know, I never really experienced any racism in Brazil, and I'm sure it exists. But I didn't experience it. Like, you know, you get everybody working together and everybody seems like I never witnessed any signs of racism. And they looked at me as if I had three heads. He said, we're all Americans. Like, you're North American, we are South American, I'm Black, you're white, we're all Americans. Like, you know, we're all one great big family. So that's great. So if you look at how things, we sometimes set ourselves up and say, well, those people down east. Of course, when I worked in Ontario, I was from down east. But now I'm in Bridgewater, Nova Scotia. It's okay. I'm far, much farther east, but it's an okay east being here. And I just never could get it, you know, having worked across the country and different countries in the world. And people are pretty much the same. There was a time that we were trying to harmonize confined space entry regulations in Canada, and we couldn't do it because we were arguing over 0.5% of oxygen in different jurisdictions, you know, oxygen content. And like, does it matter? we're not going to die from that, but we are going to die if we don't do anything about this. People sometimes manufacture barriers and obstacles rather than just what can we do? If you really wanted to, what would you do, and how would you do it?
Yeah, that's good. And I worked trying to get the NCSO program nationalized. And again, going from province to province to get everybody on the same page is like, you know, whether I stick my finger in a light socket in BC or if I stick my finger in a light socket in Nova Scotia, we're still going to get electrocuted. And it surprised me that it took us almost 2 or 3 years to get sort of everybody's on the same page because of these lines that we've sort of put in, I don't know, in whatever.
a lot of it is artificial. We set these things up, and there may be competitive interests, maybe even financial interests or political interests that get in the way. But we really want to, you know, what decision could we make if we really wanted to? If we could make any decision we wanted to, what would it be?
Right.
And, you know, it's usually really clear. And, you know, as a volunteer for many organizations, I always look at, you know, who am I here for? I'm here for, you know, the children at a hockey rink, or I'm here for the citizens for my work in public transit. And you're trying to get public transit going around here is pretty hard. But in the workplace, why am I doing the job? It's not for my own recognition. It's not, you know, hopefully the company gets the ultimate win out of this, and they're profitable and they continue to be in business. But you're doing this because of the workers. Every single worker that you're dealing with all the time, it's him or her. I have that face in front of me. That's my biggest motivator and inspiration in my life. I have that. I always carry that face, that image of a face in my mind, and everything I do, I think of that person.
Yeah, because I think that was the intention and that Tanya had in the first place when she tried to get that NCSO across the country to meet in the middle, because every province has their own little take on it. But pride, and I think pride, it comes into play quite a bit. People want to be the leaders and they want everyone else to follow, but they're forgetting why we're doing this. And I think that was the message that you tried to get across, Tanya. You know what, just to go back to some music here, Stewart, I wanted to ask you a little bit about, I think you once said that you invited certain musicians to come for dinner. Jane Seabury comes to mind, and she didn't show. Was that like a one-on-one? Were you married at the time? You said, hey, come on over and meet my wife. Or was it you were single and like, I like her, I think I'd like to meet her.
I wasn't trying to pick her up, Richard.
Oh, okay. Just wanted to get some clarity there. Yeah, okay, no worries. And it wouldn't be a shame if you were, unless you were married.
I was married, had two young children, and my wife and I had seen her in concert and her band
right.
in concert. And we invited them over for supper. And we just wanted to hang out with them. They're just such special people. She writes such wonderful music. And, probably, in my view, maybe the most underrated Canadian songwriter musician.
Yeah, she writes really intellectual lyrics. I think I would say she's a musician's musician.
Yeah, not all musicians like her, but...
No, that's true. I mean, that's the beautiful thing about music. You know, it's very personable and, you get to choose who you like. And you obviously had her on your playlist along with a few others because you're a big fan, of course, of the Beatles and Dave Matthews, as we heard earlier. You absolutely love Radiohead, which is very cool. So you're a big Canadiana fan because I see lots of Canadian musicians in your playlist. Maybe you can just, I've got some of your favorites lined up here, and they're not all Canadian, mind you, but I thought maybe we could listen to this quick little montage of some of your favorite songs on your playlist.
I'm sure The Cure will likely be in there because they are probably one of my favorite bands of all time.
That's awesome.
Excellent.
To our thoughts, the illusions of someday.
Yeah, absolutely one of my favorite albums by the Beatles, Abbey Road. What a great song, Come Together. We also heard in there, all the way from Kingston, Ahead by a Century, that's Tragically Hip. And of course, one of your all-time favorites there, one of your favorite bands, Stewart, The Cure, and Love Song. So yeah, they've got a really cool groove to their sound. They really stick out amongst many other musicians. So yeah, good choices. Nice playlist.
Yeah, I still do Love Song. Back to my sappy Love Song fetish, I guess. But I still do Love Song. Every band I play in, I always find a way to slip it into the song list.
You're such a romantic. How long have you been married, just out of curiosity?
Well, Janice and I, we met, I don't know, you may not remember, in Eastern Canada, there was a huge blackout in August 14th, 2003. The lights went out in New York, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Ontario, Quebec, and there was a huge black section of North America. Well, that's the night we met. I don't know how she pulled that off, but she must have put her finger in the socket or something. So we had an 8-year long distance relationship from that time until we finally got married in 2011. So we will have been married 10 years this August on the anniversary of our first meeting.
That's awesome. Well, happy early anniversary for you guys. So we've been listening to lots of music, which has been spectacular. But what other things do you listen to for personal growth or professional growth? Like, are you a reader? Do you listen to podcasts? What do you do besides music to increase your knowledge?
I probably do too much music and not enough professional development. I'm always taking, courses and things, whether they're just, things offered here locally through the Department of Labor or through the Chamber of Commerce or the college or whatever I can find of interest to expand my horizons and my interests more so. And, taking some digital marketing and building websites and that sort of stuff. And I do a lot of reading, mostly, periodicals and safety online blogs and whatnot, respecting health and safety and other topics. But I'd probably lately I've been reading too much stuff on politics, which is not a good thing. And I've lately weaned myself off of that, and because it was just it's so negative, and there's a lot of negative energy. So I try to only read positive things. I find myself being around in negative influences, whether it's negative people or negative environments, I try to switch to something more positive.
Now, you mentioned a blog or a book. Is there something that you would recommend to our listeners that you'd say, hey, I want to plug these. These guys are great. You should check it out. Or is there too many?
Probably too many. I'm rereading Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Mechanics again, but that's always a fun read.
Are you a motorcycle guy?
I have an old Norton Commando motorcycle, an old British motorcycle, 1975. Wow. That keeps me busy.
Wow, you are like cooler and cooler as we talk to you here.
Well, I don't know how cool it is getting dirty hands and pushing things around, but anyway, it's a lot of fun.
Oh, no, it's motorcycles and great music and safety does have personality right here. This is what we're here talking about, which is super great.
I had a couple people comment when I have a big old, you can't see it here, it's a big old hand, custom-made bass, five-string fretless bass that was custom-made by a friend of mine. It's a huge instrument, as you can see. So I put this on my backpack, and I go down the highway with this on my back on my motorcycle, and I've had a couple people inquire as to whether I had a firearm or a bazooka or something in there.
That's a great guitar. How long have you had that for?
I think this was built for me. The acoustic guitar was built probably around 2006, and this one maybe about 2009.
Yeah, that looks like, I don't mean to offend you, but if I was to describe it, for those that can't see what we're looking at, it looks like one of those guitars you would see a maracha player playing with.
That's
big
right.
Belly on it, and yeah.
It's a huge bass, and it sounds...
Oh, yeah.
The wood on the wood with, it's just a beautiful... I had to put a shout out to George Rosani. He built both of these guitars. And he's a wonderful craftsperson.
So, Stewart, let me ask you about some challenges that you have faced in the safety industry, if any. How did you overcome them with your practice, with your consulting company?
Consulting company has been sometimes trying to, you got an added problem of being a consultant, trying to get people interested in safety, but you're also trying to sell your services and yourself. And I find that it's really difficult for me to take that on. So I end up doing a lot of work for nothing, and, which is not really good to work for free, but to talk about safety needs and do assessments of people's needs and how you're going to help them to meet those needs and see their way through it. And to, maybe it's a startup company where, they need to get through those startup phases and need to ramp up their employees and get them properly trained and whatnot. So when you put together a plan, and it's a plan that you've developed with a lot of thought behind it. But it's hard maybe it's hard for people to see the passion that I have. And maybe I'm only looking at dollar signs. And so try to convince people that, this is what you need to do. Whether you want me to do it or not, I don't really care. But these are the things that you should be looking at doing. So I try to overcome those obstacles, those barriers that way. And to, whatever you do, do safety. It doesn't have to be through me, but find someone to help you if you can't do it on your own. I think often the challenge is, when do you back off? And when do you let people say, we're ready. We can do this on our own now. We don't need you. And so sometimes you stick around. I haven't, I don't think yet, but sometimes the tendency could be to stick around too long and not let that child grow up and go on on their own to be self-sufficient and, find someone in-house that can take on those roles, those duties, those tasks to manage safety or, get someone from outside to help you. And trying to get work and then trying to get out of it and is sometimes equally hard.
Yeah.
So let me ask you your opinion here, Stewart, as we, you know, begin to make our way out of this horrible pandemic. What would the teaching moment look like for you, speaking to other safety professionals, or what would it look like or be for the safety professionals to take on? I mean, what is that specialty topic that we need to be focusing on?
Well, we have to, I think, shift some of our thoughts to those essential workers, those people that are, that maybe were under-recognized, undervalued before. And I look at my my friend who's a long-haul truck driver. He goes from Nova Scotia down to Florida and other parts of the States, bringing back goods into Canada, into Nova Scotia, and maybe taking lobster down to the States or something like that. But, but you know, before, I hate to say it, it sounds terrible, but he was just a truck driver. Now he's a real hero, right, in my eyes. I think he always was, but you know, even more so now to, you know, those type of workers. You know, healthcare, the way that we manage our people that live in healthcare facilities, and those employees that may have been, you know, undervalued, underrecognized, maybe undertrained and whatnot. I think we need to do a whole lot more to help those industries, those facilities survive and do a much better job of what they're doing. And that's, you know, they're people industries, and boy, they better start looking after their own people and maybe compensating them appropriately. I think we are going to have less of a problem of people understanding what PPE means. We've heard nothing but, you know, personal protective equipment, PPE, since the pandemic started. So that's one nice thing that's happened. We won't have to explain that every time, but we also have noticed that there's, maybe it is fact that I look at our healthcare facilities that are overrun. And I look at, we have a daughter that manages an intensive care unit in California. And she has, since COVID-19 hit, she's opened up 6 additional intensive care units on the hospital property, the lawns and the parking lots. And they've ordered additional body bags and have refrigerator trucks for temporary morgues outside the hospital. You know, it's hard to think about safety and safety training when in a real major catastrophe. But we had to prepare ourselves for that. I think we need to focus a lot more on the possibility of future pandemics or other future emergency situations, disaster management situations. And maybe, you know, the way the world looks right now and the way that people seem to be more and more polarized is really troubling to me. That if we're not careful, we really get into a dystopian kind of state. So we need to help in health and safety as well as generally in society. I think we really need to help manage the message and keep people focused on, you know, we're in this together. We need to work together. We need to, you know, focus on each other and get through this. And whatever, you know, whatever this is at the moment.
Yeah. And so, you know, we forget that these frontline workers, truck drivers, supermarkets, nurses, they're all workers. And they have health and safety managers, health and safety professionals for them. We forget that they're workers. They're working, and this is their job that they're doing. And so if you were to speak to, you know, health and safety professionals that may be working in any of those industries, what do you think that maybe they need to start discussing and having conversations in the workplace as we sort of see this light at the end of the tunnel for COVID? And I know life will get to whatever that new norm is, but what would you say, or what do you think might be the things that we need to really start talking about as safety professionals?
Valuing people. We need to find a way to value people, and we don't have an unlimited pot of money. For a while, essential workers, grocery store workers, were, you know, they paid them a premium because they had to put in longer hours and they had to deal with COVID on the home front as well as in the work front and put themselves at risk. We probably can't all afford to keep paying people more money all the time, but we need to find a way that we can value them. And, you know, I think I really do think that workplace safety, occupational health and safety, and hygiene and whatnot, and also, you know, respect in the workplace, including things such as harassment and sexual harassment and violence and bullying and that kind of thing. But basic respect in the workplace, I think, is really something that health and safety professionals need to take on. It's those core health and safety programs are still going to be really, really important. You know, you still need to do your requirement, your legislative duties, your regulatory duties of inspections and training and that kind of stuff. But I think we need to find a way that we can build our workforces to be working together, to be more respectful of one another, and come, you know, you got to come through this. I think we can do it. You know, I'm not going to paint a dark picture of.
We can do it.
We can do it. We can do this. It's really difficult though, as we go through as safety professionals, to continue to not sound corny.
Yeah.
You know, like to just, you know, safety is the most important thing we do around here. Well, yeah, to us it is, but not mm-hmm. everybody. And so we need to find a way that we can sell safety to people and get people more involved. And every single person needs to play a part.
Yeah.
And feel that, maybe it's too much to say feel the love, but at least feel the value that they have a part to play.
It's true. And we need to be creative, creative. How do we let people know that they're valued? That's awesome. Thank you so much, Stewart.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I think we're going to wind down here, Stewart. But one of the things I wanted to say is that the three of us here obviously have a common denominator. We're all in safety. We all love and appreciate music. We loved listening to you play your guitar and talk about your favorite music. And one of the things that I know that you and I have in common in regard to music is that we like the same genre quite a bit. I love alternative rock, reggae music. I'll listen to it any day. No worries there. Every day that ends in Y, I'll definitely be listening to some reggae. But I'm also known to be a sucker for a good ballad, and I understand that you are too. And so Tanya and I usually take the liberty to pick a song and play it for our guest. And this time we've chosen two, and they're two ballads. So let's give a listen to them.
Where did we go wrong?
Everything is not the same now. It feels like all our lives have changed. Maybe when I'm older it'll all calm down, but it's killing me now. What if you had it all, but nobody to call? Maybe then you'd know me.
That's a very sad song, but I don't. Are you familiar with that one, Stewart?
No, I'm not. Probably because I'm not very lonely.
And I'm glad to hear that. That happens to be Justin Bieber. That's his new song, and I thought you might appreciate it because when you listen to the lyrics and you get a chance to do that, it's not a very long song, but I thought it was very. It's I think Justin Bieber really looks inside and looks and reflects on his life. I mean, we know about, you know, the life he's led and the luxuries he's enjoyed and the reputation he seems to have, built up. And what I think we come to learn and understand about him as a person is that because when you're young and you become rich and famous and you live in this glass house, you do become lonely because you're unapproachable for so many reasons, because you need your privacy and that sort of thing. But at the same time, when you get everything and you have everything, as he describes it, you become a very lonely soul and you do silly things along the way. And now he's reflecting. I think he's maturing finally, and he's starting to look back and realize, wow, I may have made a few mistakes in my time, but I'm human. And, you know, you as a musician, you've written songs, you could probably appreciate, you know, the sincerity in the words that he wrote for that.
He writes some really excellent material. And at first I wasn't really a big Justin Bieber fan, but I've maybe as he progressed, my recognition of him as a wonderful artist has as well.
Yeah, I agree with that. I did too. You know, well, he was just a kid, right? But he's got some powerful music, and he's got a really, really big heart, and he's really opening it for us to, or yeah, opening his heart for us to see.
And a great influence.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Well, it has been truly a pleasure, Stewart, getting to know you on a personal level. I really want to take a second here to say thank you for joining us today. It's been a lot of fun, and I can't wait to see you in person the next time at the next CSSE conference or wherever our paths shall cross. So thanks again for joining us today.
And is there any last, go ahead, Stewart, is there any last words you want to say before we sign off?
Just that I really do hope that we see each other in person sooner than later. And I'll be probably the person checking into the conference hotel with a guitar case, and hopefully there'll be others doing the same, bringing their instruments along, and so we can enjoy all these aspects of not only our health and safety profession, but our love for music as well.
That's awesome. So you've heard it here first from Safety Debris. If you see a gentleman checking in at the front desk of a hotel with a guitar in his backpack and he's going to a safety conference, make sure you come up and say, "Are you Stewart?"
Let's jam.
Let's jam and play. That's awesome. Well, don't forget to tune in next week for our next incredible safety personality.
And remember, don't let anyone tell you any different. Safety does indeed have a personality. We always like to finish our podcast focusing on music from Canada. So here's a trip down memory lane with a good BC boy. This is Valdi and Yes I Can on Safety Debris.
I'll be rugged if we move back to the land. I can